Hello, everyone. Oh, look at that. That is so loud. All right, just doing a quick test.
Teresa, I have a gift for you. I see you up here, Fanny. That'll work great.
want to welcome the Reverend Dr. Jerry Capel and our guest organist, Marsha Roberts, as they help us celebrate our Eucharist today. And just a reminder, we do observe COVID protocols where family units are 6 feet apart. We appreciate your cooperation with that, and thank you all very much.
Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Blessed be God's kingdom, now and forever. Amen. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. Almighty and merciful God, it is only by your gift that your faithful people offer you true and laudable service. Grant that we may run without stumbling to obtain your heavenly promises. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Amen.
A reading from the book of Deuteronomy. Moses said, "Now this is the commandment, the statutes and the ordinance that the Lord your God charged me to teach you to observe in the land that you are about to cross into and occupy, so that you and your children's children may fear the Lord your God all the days of your life and keep all his decrees and his commandments that I am commanding you, so that your days may be long. Hear, therefore, O Israel, and observe them diligently, so that it may go well with you, and so that you may multiply greatly in a land flowing with milk and honey, as the Lord, the God of your ancestors, has promised you. Hear, O Israel, the Lord is our God, the Lord alone. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, and with all your soul, and with all your might. Keep these words that I am commanding you today in your heart. Recite them to your children and talk about them when you are at home and when you are away, when you lie down and when you rise. Bind them as a sign on your hand, fix them as an emblem on your forehead, and write them on the doorposts of your house and on your gates." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to Mark.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
One One of the scribes came near and heard them disputing with one another, and seeing that Jesus answered them well, he asked him, "Which commandment is the first of all?" Jesus answered, "The first is, 'Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, and with all your soul, and with all your mind, and with all your strength.' The second is this, 'You shall love your neighbor as yourself.' There is no other commandment greater than these." Then the scribe said to him, "You are right, teacher. You have truly said that he is one, and besides him there is no other. And to love him with all the heart, and with all the understanding, and with all the strength, and to love one's neighbor as oneself, this is much more important than all whole burnt offerings and sacrifices." When Jesus saw that he had answered wisely, he said to him, "You are not far from the kingdom of God." After that, no one dared ask him any question. The gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, Lord Christ. Spirit of the living God, open our hearts to truly know the greatness of things. In the name of Christ we pray. Amen. Please be seated. So a few years ago, the Christian Century magazine, one of the premier mainline church magazines around, conducted a survey by asking several scholars, ministers, and leaders in Christianity to summarize the Christian gospel in 7 words. They sent out the assignment: what is the gospel in 7 words? And then collected and published the results. Here are several of them with some commentary from me. Martin E. Marty: God, through Jesus Christ, welcomes you anyhow. Not bad? Very warm? Kind of me and Jesus-y, maybe? M. Craig Barnes: we live by grace. Do we not also live by justice? Robert Scavanta: in Christ, God's yes defeats our no. Good news indeed. Does that say enough? Lamine Sine: God was in Christ reconciling the world. 7 words. Yes, but does God not also call us to do the same? Brian McLaren: in Christ, God calls all to reconciliation. That gets at our part of this. Ellen Schari: the wall of hostility has come down. True enough. Carol Zelensky: he led captivity captive. A direct draw from the King James Version of Ephesians 4, where captivity itself is now the captive. They have three, she had 3 words. She had said more. Scott Cairns: Christ's humanity occasions our divinity. Very Eastern Orthodox. Let me say that one again. Christ's humanity occasions our divinity. Bill McKibben, the environmentalist guy: love your neighbor as yourself. Pretty secular, actually. Where's God in that? And then Walter Brueggemann, famous Old Testament scholar: Israel's God-bodied love continues world-making. 6 words, and Brueggemann says, and I rested on the 7th. Very Old Testament, and academic. academic, but world-making. What a great word. It's a challenging assignment to do this, is it not? In many ways, to fall short. Such a limiting salvation, perhaps to my personal piety, my individual salvation by belief. I can believe some things and be saved at death, pretty good deal. Or including God's goodness, forgiveness, and grace, but make no mention of God's work of justice and reconciliation, or God's program of healing and world-making, as Brueggemann calls it. Or limiting its scope to humans only and leaving out the renewal of the rest of creation, as Paul would put it. Or leaving out the call to us to join in God's work of justice and peace. How about you? What would you write? Here's one for me. In Christ, creation becomes whole. Join in. What would your seven words be? Would they prioritize God's love, forgiveness, and grace? Mention both life and death, or just one or the other? Would it contain some words for justice, reconciliation, and healing? Would it mention sin or brokenness, or is that reality so overshadowed by grace that it's now past tense, beyond the need to mention? Would it include all creation? Or just humans? And then only some humans? Like repentant ones? Or humans universally? Would your answer allow inclusion for those who claim to be spiritual but not religious? Or would its few words embrace the God seekers and truth tellers in other religious traditions? And in light of today's gospel, how would it balance love of God and neighbor? God is near. Love God and neighbor. I think this would be a fun retreat, actually. Kind of a good classroom exercise. Even though some of you may be sitting there and saying, how many angels can dance on the head of a pin? But it forces us to sift and prioritize what we really think and feel. And for that, which we might live and die. The debate we witness in the text today, in Mark, was not a new thing in that day either, nor was the question as presented to Jesus a new one. It was just the sort of thing the Jewish people had been doing for centuries and still do. And Jesus did not newly create his answers of love of God and neighbor. Rabbis before him had enjoined those same two themes as a summation of the faith. What Jesus was doing, perhaps, was taking sides with the prophets who were before him. If you want to name a new edge that Jesus may have brought to the religious debate, it was probably not love of neighbor, it was love of the enemy. The parable of the Good Samaritan, the way of the cross, the laying down of swords, which is a whole lot harder than love of neighbor. I think this essence of religious question, this essence of religion question, is very alive in our own day. It's all around us. It lies behind the charges lodged against the church of hypocrisy and irrelevance. It lies beneath the common phrase, I am spiritual but not religious. And the, I find more God in nature, or on the golf course, than in church. And from the inside, it also challenges us who believe, perhaps, that because I believe the right things, my character flaws of bitterness and bigotry really don't matter. And also the either belong to my church or go to hell version, which we have around us. And so on and so on. And it plays if we face the question that lies behind much of this modern secular critique of the church. Do we even need religion to obey the greatest commandments of love of God and neighbor? Can those be done outside of faith communities and without centuries of tradition? What if there's some truth that we find more love of God and neighbor outside of churches than within them? How do we respond to that? They're asking in our day what is most central to religion and faith, and which is perhaps uniquely different in our modern day between us and the folks in the Gospel of Mark, is that we can be secular. They could not. They were not asking whether God was important or whether religion was important. Both of those were just assumed. It was not in their worldview to even ask a secular question. The question about the value of religion and the reality of God, though, is a modern one. We don't ask what's the greatest commandment. We ask whether there's any commandments at all. So what if we reframe the question for our modern selves? And instead of asking what's the greatest commandment, we rephrase it something more like, what is the greatest good in life? What's the most authentic and real? What is that which is most important to engage now and have engaged when all is said and done? These are the questions we do often ask in life. And in some fashion or another, consciously or otherwise, we're about to be inundated with them as we watch the abundance, ad nauseum some would say, of the Christmas holiday specials that are about to show up on our TV sets. We're all those misguided lovers and overworked business types and genuine Scrooges will eventually come to realize that love, and sometimes romance, is the reason for the season. Behind these various plot lines is a version of our question, what is the greatest good, the greatest command? How do I want to measure my life before God? We would rightly add, when I sum it up and look back on it. The religious version of it is, with what shall I come before the Lord? That I've been loving and been loved? That I've been faithful? That I've been moral and just? That I have done some good and gave back? That I learned how to be happy and content? To have made good spiritual journey out of my life? To have been on some kind of goodly, godly adventure? This matters because it follows from our answers to these questions that we then every day choose something. Every moment, we're choosing. I'm constantly answering these questions every time I make a choice about something. These questions, consciously or not, force us to sort out and declare what it is we treasure in our hearts. Of all the myriad choices that come our way every day, what moves us? So it's a challenging command indeed, this love the Lord your God with all your heart. Obeying it so can be very slippery within our mixed motivations and our ease of self-deception. Let me share a good story. It's from the Norwegian novelist Johan Boyer, The Great Hunger. It happened that an antisocial newcomer moved into the local village, put a fence around his property with a sign saying, keep out. He also put a vicious dog in the fence to keep anyone from climbing it. One day, the neighbor's little girl reached inside the fence to pet the dog. The dog grabbed her by the arm and savagely bit, mauled, and killed her. The townspeople were, of course, enraged and refused to speak to the recluse. They wouldn't sell him any groceries at the store. When it came time for planting, they wouldn't sell him any seed. The man became destitute and didn't know what to do. But one day he saw another man sowing seed on his field. He ran out and discovered it was the father of the little girl. "Why are you doing this?" he asked. The father replied, "I'm doing this to keep God alive in me." So that's something of that determined love of the greatest commandment, is it not? It's not just a personal desire to feel God's presence, to enjoy showing charity toward the less fortunate. It's not necessarily feel good at all. Rather, it's a determined desire to stay alive to God and to live the life of God. It's a tough determination that sometimes takes all our heart and soul and mind and strength to do. It's not dependent on sentiment or being likable or liking people or other creatures. It's more like the determined engagement of hard soul work, like forgiveness, sacrifice, love. And being church is where we put these kind of things into effect, or we try. Because this is where we each commit ourselves to that soul work of keeping God alive. Yeah. So our answer to the spiritual but not religious crowd, the golf course seekers and the secular skeptics, is that we are here, gathered as church, trying to create a place where we work together to keep God alive in us. To be a place where the love of God and love of neighbor is claimed and engaged, because we believe that is indeed the core value of life. That when all is said and done, for us, that's the greatest thing. Together with the present people? Yes?
In peace, we pray to you, Lord God, for the church's mission and ministry, that we may build a community of love and service which flows from the community of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. For all people in their daily life and work. For this community, the nation, and the world. For Joe, our president, and Andy, our governor. For all those serving in the armed forces and currently on active duty. For the just and proper use of your creation, for our enemies and all those who perpetuate violence and all victims of violence.
For the victims of hunger, fear, injustice, and oppression.
For all who are in danger, sorrow, or any kind of trouble. For the peace and unity of the Church of God.
For all who proclaim the gospel and all who seek the truth.
For Michael, our presiding bishop, Terry, our bishop, Mary, our deacon, our visiting clergy, and for all bishops and other ministers. For the Episcopal Anglican Province of Alexandria, for All Saints Center and Racial Healing, for our choir master, cantors, choir, and music ministry.
For all who serve God in this church.
For the special needs and concerns of this congregation, for those whose names are on our parish prayer list, and for those who have received our healing blankets. Hear us, Lord. We thank you, Lord, for all the blessings of this life, for those celebrating anniversaries and birthdays. We We will exalt you, O God our King.
We praise your name forever and ever.
We pray for all who have died, that they may have a place in your eternal kingdom. Lord, let your loving kindness be upon them.
Put their trust in you.
We pray for the Rector's Search Committee. Almighty God, giver of every good gift, look graciously on St. James Church, and so guide the minds of those who shall choose a rector for this parish, that we may receive a faithful pastor who will care for your people and equip us for our ministries. We pray to you also for the forgiveness of our sins. Have mercy upon us, most merciful Father. In your compassion, forgive us our sins, known and unknown, things done and left undone. And so uphold us by your Spirit, that we may live and serve you in newness of life, to the honor and glory of your name, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Almighty God, have mercy on you. Give you all your sins to our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen you in all goodness by the power of the Spirit, keep you in eternal life. Amen. And the peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Stand. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to give our thanks and praise. It is right and a good and joyful thing, always and everywhere, to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. For you are the source of light and life. You made us in your image and called us to new life in Jesus Christ, our Lord. Therefore, we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name.
Holy.
gracious Father, in your infinite love, you made us for yourself. And when we had fallen into sin and become subject to evil and death, you, in your mercy, sent Jesus Christ, your only and eternal Son, to share our human nature, to live and die as one of us, to reconcile us to you, the God and Father of all. He stretched out his arms upon the cross and offered himself in obedience to your will, a perfect sacrifice for the whole world. On the night he was handed over to suffering and death, the Lord Jesus Christ took bread. And when he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine. And when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sin. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. We celebrate the memorial of our redemption, O Father, in this sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving, recalling his death, resurrection, and ascension. We offer you these gifts. Sanctify them by your Holy Spirit to be for your people the body and blood of your Son, the holy food and drink of new and unending life in him. Sanctify us also that we may faithfully receive this holy sacrament and serve you in unity, constancy, and peace. And at the last day, bring us with all your saints into the joy of your eternal kingdom. All this we ask for your Son, Jesus Christ, by him and with him and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. Now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Hallelujah, Christ our Passover sacrificed for us.
Therefore, let us keep the feast.
Hallelujah. The gifts of God, the people of God, take them in remembrance of Christ died for you. Feed on Christ in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving. Let us pray. Eternal God, Heavenly Father, you have graciously accepted us as living members of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and you have fed us with spiritual food in the sacrament of his body and blood. Send us now into the world in peace, and grant us strength and courage to love and serve you with gladness and singleness of heart. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. The blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with you and remain with you, now and forever.
The stewardship committee asked me to say a couple of words, so here I am. My name is Henrietta Pepper Plafancic. My husband, Larry, and I have been members of St. James for 34 years. We were married here in 1990. Our three children were baptized and confirmed here. My four stepchildren attended often growing up. My oldest stepdaughter, Jessica, was married here by Father Paul Jeans. Evan, my youngest stepson, was an acolyte in Crucifer while he was living with us in Elma County. Our daughters and son also were engaged with the church programs throughout their childhood and continue to visit often. So, we have an obvious love for this church and its congregation that runs deep into our hearts and minds. And while we've seen a lot of changes occur over the years, one thing never wavers. That's the specialness of the people of St. James and their love of God. Speaking of change, I started thinking about the evolution of this parish since our journey with St. James began. We've celebrated milestones like building Gleason Hall, resurrecting our cemetery, building the playground, starting the preschool, planting our beautiful prayer garden, and most recently, our lovely walkway and wall in memory of our beloved Austin Hannah. We've endured disasters, storms taking down huge trees and parts of our buildings with them. Air conditioning and heating issues linger every year. Critters in our organ, leaks, flooding, and electrical problems. We've had break-ins, we've had burglaries. We've seen our parish shrink to a little more than 15 people at one service, and we've seen it grow to 3 services every Sunday and a weeknight service as well. Under Daniel Martin's leadership, our music program has grown and evolved into a true beacon for our parish. Our women of the church and daughters of the King do their great work. Our ministries, such as the prayer blankets, which have been adopted by many parishes across the country since we developed that ministry, and I'm proud to say my home church in Bowling Green, Kentucky has recently adopted the program. Our laundry service, food bags, wellness, health fairs, working with underserved youth, hosting organizations on our site to do their good work, and the list goes on. So while we enjoy the beauty of these historical grounds and buildings, many resources are needed to maintain them. While we continue to offer our many helpful programs, operate our school, and spread the word throughout our community, it takes staff, it takes physical goods, it takes financial means to sustain those efforts. Through it all, St. James has somehow managed to stay the course in living its mission, loving people and serving people. I recently authored a book, which is a compilation of short stories around faith and family and friends. And ironically, the first section of the book is titled Stay the Course. I think this excerpt gets right to the point and the core of our stewardship mission. So let me try to endure a couple of sentences, sorry. It's a natural tendency to attempt to map out a well-defined, clear pathway for life, and then life gets in the way. Hello, COVID, right? If I only knew then what I know now is a phrase that comes to mind. Sure, there are things that I would have done differently or decisions I would have made sooner or later in some cases, but when it's all said and done, isn't the best course of action just to try to stay the course? Life gets sloppy, there are interruptions, yet if we could all rally around the idea of staying true to ourselves and true to God, and grounded in our personal beliefs and values, navigating the seasons of life will seem more purposeful. Staying the course is tough, for certain, but it's also doable and worth it, one day at a time. I think we all realize that St. James is worth it. It's worth it for our hearts, our souls, our minds. So, Larry and I joined the stewardship committee in asking you to reflect on your personal journeys with God. How can you dig a little deeper this year with giving more of your time and talent and treasure? What's one extra way you can give? To stand up to that challenge, I've made copies of my book available here at St. James, and I'm committed to giving 100% of the proceeds for the book sales during November and December back to St. James. 22 is a year where every dollar and every hour of time and talent is going to be needed to support this parish in 2022 and beyond. I know you all agree we are all blessed to have this parish in our lives today. Let's stay the course to ensure this parish endures for years to come. Thank you.
That to benefit St. James, but it is a very, very good read, very heartfelt. I highly recommend it to anybody. So with that, I want to just do a few announcements real quickly. Happy Halloween to everybody. I hope you have a very great day. And thanks to Reverend Capel, who's in the back, and Marsha for celebrating our Eucharist with us. The choir is going to be having their rehearsal at 11 in Gleason Hall, even without Daniel with us today. our annual meeting, which will be mostly a presentation from the Rector Search Committee, is the 14th. So please, please be there, plan to attend and hear what we're doing. The Deacon's discretionary fund for this month is the Episcopal Church Home. One reminder, next Sunday, November 7th, daylight savings time ends. Fall back an hour, we get an extra hour of sleep, be sure to change your clocks. And at the same time, change your batteries and your smoke detectors and your CO detectors. It's very important that those stay up and current. Next Sunday will also be the day that we're collecting our food bags for Oakland County Red Cross Food Bank. Ed's back there, he's holding bags so that if you don't have a bag to bring your food up, please see him on your way out. We'll also bless our healing blankets and blankets of joy at that same time. So be sure to come and enjoy. The next sewing date for the blankets is the 22nd of November at 9:30 in the Undercroft. I hope everybody has a very blessed day. Thank you all for coming.